I'm glad I could finally make it.
The whole idea is to have a conversation.
To be myself?
Well, to the degree to which you choose to be.
Sure. Awesome.
Who knows what anybody...
Can't really write me in if I get a little kooky over here.
Is there any signals from the background? Your journey as an actor has been going on for a little while.
Yeah, 15 years.
15 years.
About, yeah.
And now you're 25, so you started when you were 10.
I wish I was still 25. I mean, I don't think I would go back in my 20s at all. Those were some interesting years.
So what got you going in it in the first place?
In the business?
Yeah.
My sister was like an actress a little bit. She was like on one of, she made a guest appearance on one of my favorite shows as a little girl called The Secret World of Alex Mack. She played a bully on rollerblades, and I thought it was the coolest thing I'd ever seen because I love rollerblades and my sister. But I was really shy, you know, I was really, really shy, but her representatives were always curious if I wanted to do it, and I was at a bar mitzvah dancing, and you know, there's a story that I've told a lot. This bar mitzvah kid's manager really wanted me to get into it, and I was just so shy, but I decided to go on a couple commercial auditions to like try it out. And I booked my first two. My first two, back to back, which was for Starburst and Eggo Waffles. I had a lot of fun shooting those commercials, and like I made good money. It was like, oh wow, this is something I could do. But then I had the benefit of meeting really cool artists like Mike Mills and Larry Clark very early on. And they were kind of those influential people who kind of set me down a path of like, what is it that I love about filmmaking and what is it that I want to do or say or be? And so I think I kind of started there.
So Mike is a serious artist.
Serious artist.
He's like an artist of like all kinds of artists.
He's beautiful.
And Larry has a weird reputation in the universe, though he's done amazingly interesting stuff.
Yeah.
So, I mean, is it like the good angel and the bad angel on your two shoulders, or are you... Is it all about art, or is it about...
No. Oh, you mean, is it all about art?
At that point.
No, I mean, for me, it was, I was just so... happy to be working. I really knew nothing about it. I mean, Mike Mills took me from pretty much looking like this, but like 15, like just like blonde, like LA girl, and like dyed my hair like black and blue. And I remember we were shooting, this is so embarrassing, this is gonna be so embarrassing, but we were shooting in like a bedroom of like a teenage girl, but she had like a bunch of like NSYNC posters up, and he like, all his art department team like just spread it with like Joy Division and The Cure, and I was like, who the fuck are these guys? So I was like 15, I was like, why did you cover up NSYNC with these weirdos? And Mike was just like, oh, she's so young. I really knew not, you know, I grew up in Thousand Oaks, and I'm from like Bakersfield, California. But meeting both of those guys, for me and for my mother and for my family, who were all involved in that process, was just so cool, because it was a type of art form that I didn't even know existed. You know, it was a type of voice I didn't even know that I liked or that like intrigued me. So it's not like good or bad shoulder, and I never like set out to be this like artist for the sake of art, because I think I didn't know what art was when I was younger. And so it was just, in hindsight, I'm super thankful for those men and that kind of like, I mean, I've worked with some really cool directors who have all in their own right are these really amazing artists, and I love that I get to do that. Part of me is like, why? I don't understand. It's really fun. It's really fun.
So did you become a show business girl at some point, or was it always, were you always kind of floating in a place where you kind of wanted to find things that were more challenging or more interesting? Or
I think this is me attempting to be show business. Like, I think I'm finally embracing that maybe over the last kind of 5 years. I mean, I think I did fall in love with art really, really early on. And I definitely didn't just want to like do anything or be just an actress or like, you know, like I definitely was trying to figure out who I am and what I want to say. So I think this is maybe the most showbiz I've been, you know, doing something. Lately, some of my moves have been much more commercial. Television has become this beautiful medium, and some great artists are working there. So if you would have told like a 19-year-old version of me that I would play Marilyn Monroe for a four-hour Lifetime miniseries, I would have been like, get the fuck out of here, man. This is, in what multiverse? Like, which one? You know, not this one, for sure, but...
And Pan Am the same way?
Pan Am kind of the same way, you know, it was also, to be honest, like me, I had moved representatives at the time because I felt like I was stuck, like I was wanting something more and I didn't know how to find it, and I had been acting for a while, so I switched representatives probably around the time of like the writer's strike too. So I remember it was just a time where like things were changing, and so I just wanted to stay open. So yeah, those were just guidance in different areas of like, hey, like this is actually cool and this is actually a really classy show, and like I think this could be really good for you. You've never embraced your brand or your like woman or your beauty in a way, you know. I've always played very, very, very different, weird, off characters, which I love because I'm really different, weird, and off. But you know, there's a commercial side to me that have become more aware of as I've gotten older that I like to play around with.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So did you have a moment where that hit you, or were you just looking for something and this is kind of one of the things that came along?
Well, I think I also became an adult, you know, and I think I also needed to live and survive. And as you become older, your family and the friends that you choose and those people you, it's like responsibility. And so at one point too, like I had to be practical. Mm-hmm. And so there was a pragmatism that came in that I was like, okay, this is great. Look, I'm always looking for consistency. It's something that I want so much in my life. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if I'm ever going to get it. And I don't know if it exists, especially being an artist. It's funny that I've like chosen to be an actor. I'm like, I realize I want consistency in my life. But you know, certain things like television shows can offer you that, mm-hmm. and a stability and a security that allows a different type of freedom and allows a different type of artistic voice to kind of come out when you want it to. So, you know, it's been a journey. I've been here for a long time.
So were you surprised how that something like Pan Am was fulfilling in the process of doing it? Or as fulfilling as other things you've done? Or was it?
Well, I didn't say it was fulfilling.
But the outfits were so great.
Oh, I know. And I got to tell you, still some of my good girlfriends, you know, beautiful experience. I've got one staying with me from London right now, which is on the street. It was a learning experience. I don't think without the education of what it takes to be a 1-hour drama actor, I have like mad respect for the 1-hour drama actor. That is hard work. And so to understand that, I was thankful it only went for 14 episodes. It was a hard show. You know, you learn the politics of TV, like, you know, studio network, cooks and kitchen, you know, you just learn it all, budget, production value, you know, you're just becomes a different thing. Mm. Or your direction, like come episode 8 is more like, oh, Kelli, will you just deliver that line, but like with your chin up, because you're kind of angled prettier, and you're like, fuck, that's my fucking director. Did I say my line right? Is anybody listening? Is anybody out there? And also when a show starts to sink, it's interesting. I need an audience. I think as an actor, most people do. You need somebody to perform to, and there's something that happens to, at least a little bit for me, I felt like you lose your audience, you lose your crew, people kind of start checking out, you know. It was a really interesting experience and hard. So I don't think it was fulfilling, I think it was educational. I don't think I would have been able to handle playing Marilyn for 4 hours, shooting that in as little time as we did, 7 scenes a day for like 42 days straight, if I wouldn't have understood what it really took.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that was something that the director was looking for as well, because, you know, she had done a lot of indie films and everyone was like, look, get TV, get people who know that world.
So how did it come to you in the first place, Marilyn?
In an email, and I laughed. It's like, my Lord. I guess I was on a short list. Lori, the director, has always said that I was on a short list for her of somebody to play it. I can't say I've always wanted to play it, but it's definitely floated around in my universe a bit, opportunities or ideas or people telling me I should. Mm-hmm. I got the Norma Jean thing a lot. I thought that just meant that I was like a young girl trying trying to be an actress. Maybe mm-hmm. that is what they meant. Who knows? But, you know, my manager, John Carabino, saw it as a real opportunity for me. And always tried to keep me on the positive side of like how, what you can learn as an actress from doing mm-hmm. something, because it's also extremely terrifying, because it's a big risk, big fail, big risk, big reward. Mm-hmm. Like, you just never know, and you're kind of in control of a lot of that. So I sat down with Jonathan Koch, one of the executive producers, after they'd kind of sifted through, like, they were all over the place, I think, and what they wanted to do initially. And I sat down with him, and I liked him, and it went from, like, being, like, consensus that I was the girl, and then to me fucking jumping through hoops, which made me laugh, because then it was like, oh, fuck you guys, you just made me realize that I want it, because now I'm coming back in for the fourth time. I flew to New York to test with Susan, and I was like, oh, like, and it was funny, it was this learning experience where maybe if it was something that just kind of got handed to me, I wouldn't have I treated it the same way as having to then realize you have to fight for something, and then you can't deny that it to yourself, that you're like, oh, I want this, and oh, if this doesn't go my way, like, I'll be disappointed, because I actually think I can do something cool here, and I think I need to, like, for, you know, me. So that's how it came about.
So what, I mean, once you got it, what was the balance between figuring out how to perform as Marilyn and figuring out how to just do the performance?
I mean, if there is a balance, you know, like, for me, when I watch it, I'm like, I wish I had these, like, imaginary dials, because I'm like, turn down, turn up, what are you doing with your face? Like, what, you know, like, for me, it's still a work in progress. I mean, maybe it's just hard to watch something like that, but, you know, I always knew that I want it to be like a balance between an interpretation and an impersonation and my own truth. Because, you know, I understood some things there. I think a lot of women actually understand some things there. I think there's a little Marilyn Monroe in every woman. So it was, you know, it was trial and error and a lot of trust and a lot of blind faith and a lot of hard work.
Well, I mean, one of the things that's striking about it, and I...
Yeah, talk to me.
Being told that you were, you know, asked whether I would interview you, I went and looked at this thing, and it was like, you know, I don't know, it's a Lifetime movie. I don't know what to expect.
Sure, that's I mean, I got that email too, you know.
Yeah. Looking at it, I'm like, I thought it's actually probably the best Marilyn performance I've ever seen. And I loved Michelle Williams' performance, but hers is more of an interpretation than it is a manifestation, and yours,
like,
somehow you channel the physicality in a way.
Well, I love hearing it. You're sitting across me for 10 minutes. I'm like, does he like it? Does he not? Like, what's gonna happen when we start talking about it?
Well, I've never seen anybody do it who kind of got the really the sex of it.
Oh,
I mean, I think that's a lot of what it is. She touches. She, you know, she moves. She's very sensual. She's not. Yeah.
She's such a flirt. One of my favorite photographs of Marilyn Monroe is her sitting on a couch with, like, this 10-year-old little boy, got, like, his socks pulled up and whatever those things are that hold him. Oh, you know, just, like, looks like his legs shouldn't work. Just, like, super dorky little boy. And she's sitting next to him, and by my God, like, she's not doing this that she does,
right.
Or, you know, like, she's not. But she, you know, she leans back a little bit with respect, but she is flirting with this 10-year-old little boy in this photo, you know? And she can't help it, you know? It's, I don't know if it's Norma Jean or if it's her identity, you know, her Gemini alter ego of Marilyn Monroe, but she can't turn it off. And it's in everything. It's in every tiny movement. And I think she's a genius at nonverbal communication, and that happens to be one of my favorite things.
But it also seems to be her pleasure. I mean, she seems to, when she's with DiMaggio, or she's with, the physicality of those scenes feel like she, it's not a act,
mm-mm.
necessarily, you know.
No,
sometimes you can see the act.
Mm-hmm. I think it was a combination.
Yeah.
I think it was a combination, you know, I think it was her power. I understand it a little bit, loving nonverbal communication, because when I was starting to act and starting to, like, go and have the, I had, like, the chance to, like, be on the home princess homecoming court, I remember, or go do bullying for Larry Clark. And I was like, which experience do I want? Because I got handed this red rose and I kind of really want to like put on a tiara and a sparkly dress. And then I'm like, I kind of really want to go work with this fucking weird director. You told me I could cuss.
Well, you're good at it, so it's
thank you. So I actually, you know, at one point as a sophomore, dropped out of high school. I had to do homeschooling. You know, I still educate myself. I still take extension courses. But there was something about me that was always, I never felt like I was smart enough or I fully got my education or I knew how to articulate things that I wanted to say because I was kind of pulled from that environment. And I, when reading a lot about her, like one of her biggest fears was that she was not smart enough, you know? And I think when you feel that way, or at least for me when I felt that way, you start to learn how to communicate in a different way that doesn't need words. And it can be really beautiful, you know? So I love her body language because I think she says so much without having to say anything at all.
And it's her.
It's her. It's her.
Yeah. I mean, that's the thing. Watching it, you realize, I think, more than I realized before, how much I recognize those things as being the definition of who she was.
Cool.
In the work.
Cool.
So was it painstaking? I mean, is it, do you just find the place and these things manifest, or?
Yeah, I think the audition process, like the finding it, was painstaking, you know, at first. Especially because I have this really stupid way of like putting everything in my way that like my friend Joel, who works with me, he's just like, God damn it, Kelly. Like, will you just hurry up and, like, get over all this, like, bullshit that you need to do so, like, we can just get to the work, you know? So it was definitely painstaking, and, you know, you have to go really big, and you fucking laugh at yourself, or, you know, you do something in an audition, and your director's like, or, like, don't do the voice, or, you know, it's just, like, it was so hard, and I just wanted to have the freedom to play around, because when I don't have freedom, well, I think I've become a very boring actress. Yeah, it was a lot of hard work, but then you do kind of click in. And I'm also kind of this silly believer in like world knowledge and source energy, and I don't know if everything really dies ever, you know, and manifestation and channeling and law of attraction. So, you know, I tried to just I tried to just really like keep myself in a headspace. So with like the physical work and like just the work of learning the scenes and watching everything. I'd go to bed watching her. I'd fall asleep. Her voice would probably still be on in the background. Like there was an immersion in a way, you know, where I just had to trust that I had found my own version. And you trust your crew. You know, here was my thing. I was like, okay, Joel, if I can get the crew to feel like they're like hanging out with Marilyn Monroe, if I can convince like all like those little people in a weird way, like, oh shit, she's good, she's got something, then half my job is done, you know? Because when you walk onto onto your stage and people, especially with all that hair and makeup too, and they kind of like stop or they're seeing it for the first time, or you know, it's like, and when you can kind of like convince or let every part of the team be along for the ride of some like delusion, like, oh yeah, Marilyn Monroe is in there. Then I think like it's just general energy too, that like it just helps with everything. It helps trick me, like when somebody looks at you like they think you're look so much like her, like then it just helps me in my delusion of needing to believe for 2 months that like I am her in like some weird way, so I can just commit, you know, and do my job. You know, it's hard to commit to playing a real person because you have to go a little crazy because you have to tell you, you know, you have to convince yourself. You're like, I'm Marilyn Monroe in this scene, you know, I'm channeling her right now. Like, you know, we're crazy. But
and even though there are other famous people in the movie, you really are the only one who has to deliver that.
Yeah.
I mean, Jeffrey Dean Morgan did not have to be DiMaggio, for instance.
No.
You know, he was, no, he, I think it's actually one of his best performances, but
I like him in
yeah,
it.
Yeah, he's really good in it, but it's not, you know, it's not like he's channeling the details of Joe DiMaggio.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's a different kind of performance.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's a really controlled performance.
Yeah.
And I'm a fan of those type of performances because I feel like sometimes I'm super spastic as an actress. Like, I don't know how many times I've, in an audition room, been told to sit on my hands. So, like, great, great, it's wonderful. Sit on your hands. Dude, and I'm like, because I'm, like, all over the place. And so when someone can be so controlled, it's not something I've, like, keyed into just yet, or maybe I just haven't found the right performance or character to do it. But I love it, and it always throws me as an actor at first. Because I'm like, why is he not doing anything? Like I feel like I'm moving and he's not. And then you watch it back and you just realize, oh, he gets it. Like, he knows what's also going to work for the camera. Like, that guy's really smart, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, he gets so many different elements of it. And when you watch it back and it's, like, more powerful than it even was in front of you, it makes me go, oh, he knows what he's doing. He knows what he's doing. And I think we have really good chemistry. Which is funny because I can't always say I felt it, you know, because, you know, you meet and then 5 minutes later you're like having to do, our first scene was him slapping Marilyn. And I'm like, God. Really, guys? Like, who made this schedule? Like, why are you doing this to him and me, you know? And so it's like sometimes you just have to, like, fake it until you make it. And so I was really happy to see that there was some chemistry there. That was, I mean, he's a very attractive man, and I had enjoyed shooting with him. I don't know, I've never embraced my sexual side, I think, really, as an actress ever, too, so maybe it's just interesting to see me in so many compromising positions, because I, you know, I have not really ever done that either.
Well, I will say that the movie, one of the things that's striking about the movie, and I think that the shooting is great, and I think the costumes are stunning also, but, I mean, Marilyn's body is very much a part of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
And every costume and every, you know, curve and every choice and every bra and every whatever. But it's not just sexy, it's like it's part of the whole thing in a weird way.
It's part of the thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can't. That's also another reason why I wanted to do it. You can't play Marilyn Monroe and not bring out your, like, ultimate sex kitten. Yeah. And, like, I knew I had it because I use it behind closed doors, but I'd never embraced it. Like, I'm a flirt. All my friends know, like, in a good way and in a bad way, you know? Like, but I'd never used it as an actor. I'd never felt comfortable using it. So that was also, like, really fun because I was like, oh. I mean, like, how about that Tom Kelly nude photo shoot? Like, how about for Lifetime for, like... You putting that in.
Well, my favorite part, like, of that is the wife.
Right. Good direction by Lori. It's great. Yeah. She's a little... Mm-hmm.
She's going for it. My husband likes his work. I don't mind it either.
Yeah. Yeah. She's like, you're beautiful. No, I know, but it's just like all those kind of sexual undertones. It was really... I was thinking when I was shooting, it was like, well, this is never going to make it in. You know, it's Lifetime. It's like, you know, they've got, you know, too many... maybe advertisers that, like, aren't used to that or whatnot, but it was, like, really nice and refreshing to see they just put a little clause before that hour, and it was like, we're gonna do this, and I'm like, good, like, you have to get a little provocative sometimes if you want to kind of, like, step outside of your comfort zone. I'm happy that they did that.
So were you watching dailies? Were you watching footage?
I wasn't. Mm-mm.
So have you, when did you finally see the movie?
At the premiere. I saw good 7 hour chunks in ADR. And I was happy.
Mm-hmm.
I was pissed that I had to ADR some of that, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, you're like, really, guys? But I don't hear it. Good engineers. I don't hear it. But yeah, I walked in there at the premiere, and they had to do something weird at the premiere too, because you can't show 4 hour. You have a 4 hour premiere, so they showed the second half. So I saw the second half first with, like, a bend row of, like, all my friends. I could see them all, my family. And I was like, this has to be really disjointing for everybody. Like, I can kind of follow it because I get it.
Right.
But, you know, I think it's always hard. You know, I think it's always hard. It's weird. It's like when you watch something for the first, it's like too much is happening. You know, you're like, oh, I was there. And, like, there's that guy that was, like, holding the boom and the weird tape over there. And, like, I couldn't move. And I, you know, and I'm just like, smells. Mm. It's so, like, it's like static to me when I see something that I'm in for the first time. He's smiling. But, like, around the second, you know, like when so I watched it at the premiere, and then I watched it live when it aired with my new Twitter account. that my publicist helped me. I got the blue check mark. I don't know what it means. But it was so bizarre because I was like watching it live. It was like 5 o'clock here or something. My phone just started exploding. I was like, oh shit, it's 8 o'clock in New York. And that's also this weird cool thing that you can watch something live with like your fans or people who like, are watching it. They can like communicate with you. But like when I watched it live, I had a much better relationship with just like the flow of it. And I'm happy with it.
So your self-consciousness kind of slid away a little bit? Sing it again?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think the first time you're just hyper aware of everything, you know? And then the second time, you can kind of sit back and watch everybody else's work. That's what it is. The first time I'm too much watching everything that I'm doing, and then the second, then I get it out of the way, and then the second time I get to see what everyone else has done, from like the beautiful sets to the costumes to the, you know, other actors. But at first, it's just this thing of like, what have I done? Is it okay? Is it gonna work? So yeah, the second time is just fuller.
So did you surprise yourself while watching it at all? What was the most surprising thing?
That I took all my clothes off for the tongue. No. There's moments in there for me. I hear certain lines that aren't me. They're not my voice. Like, you know, like I had to do so much work and changing it and mannerisms and like hair and makeup. And so there's moments where it's the right lighting, the right angle, the right like line that for me, I'm like, whoa, that felt like Marilyn Monroe to me. Moments. And those are really surprising and fun, you know?
And when do you take your pleasure from the work? Is it actually doing it? Is it completing it? Is it the process of getting there?
I pull pleasure the whole way through, you know? It's all just different types of pleasure, you know? There's pleasure in the chase and the realization that you want it and the fight. And there's pleasure in the booking it. And that's like re-energizing. You know, you do the hard work and then you book it, so you get to celebrate for like a couple weeks and then you get it, and then you got to work again. But that's when you recharge. The celebration is charge. And really our job is, my job is just to be a great auditioner. And then I'm lucky that when I get to celebrate. I had a really beautiful moment. It was after the first week, because we didn't shoot chronologically except for the therapy sessions were all in chronological order, and it was all first week of shooting, which I was like, really? We couldn't have started with like Norma Jean at 15? And there was a end of that week, and it was 7 scenes a day, and I was working my ass off, and you're nervous too, because a lot of other people I've been working their ass off a lot longer than you have. I'm like the last peg in, you know? And it's nervous you to also like those that first day, that first week of shooting, because that's, like I said, like that's when your crew's either in or out. And I think your crew and the energy of your crew is so important. And at the end of the first week, at the last shot, there was just like all this clapping. I was clapping and I was like delusional already at that point. And I was like, yay! And then I looked around and I realized they all stood up and started clapping for me. And that was a moment where I took a lot of pleasure from. Because it's nice to be a part of a team and to be recognized for like hard work and to then be, you know, obviously it's just specific part of it, the Marilyn Monroe of it, and to just have that like mini celebration, not too much, they only did it once, they didn't look over my head too much, but it was just, I felt like a really beautiful nonverbal love letter of like, great, this is great, let's we've got some fun times ahead of us. It's a nice moment for me.
And do you leave the work at some point behind, or does it stay with you forever? Or?
Yeah, they all stay with me. You know, it's interesting. Years ago, I like got like Rising Star Award at some small festival that I don't remember, but they had put together a montage of like my work, And I'd never seen my work montaged like that before. And I was like, oh God, ladies, where have you been? Friends, why aren't we hanging out more? Let's go out, let's have dinner. Let's go, who wants to go for a walk? Because you realize they're all beautiful parts. Like, you know, for me, I love all my characters that I've created and played, you know? And for me, I was like, fuck. It's like, oh, all my best friends that I've been missing all these years. Like, where have you guys been? So yeah, they always stay with me and they always inform me for my next thing. And, but I have a feeling, Marilyn's not going to leave me because she's just too much fun. And my friends tell me when I go out and drink that she comes out, and it's true, you know, because I did a lot of drinking to prepare for Marilyn Monroe at times, you know, not to say that she was a drinker. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that I had to get so out of my own inhibitions, and there's moments where she is drunk in it, you know, she's had two glasses of champagne, and I don't know what pill she took, but I can tell you what it probably did. And so there was moments where you could do that, and so like I found her sometimes after a few glasses of champagne where I just stopped micromanaging everything and like allowed for like a real, because she's a goof, she's a kook, she's a fuddy-duddy, she's so many things. And so yeah, my friends tell me occasionally when I'm drunk, they're like, oh, hello, Marilyn. So I have a feeling she's gonna, I kind of want her to stay around.
And is there some place, do you now have an idea of where you want to go next? Is there a ambition now that you've tried this particular cloak out of a more, you know, traditional Hollywood work?
Yeah, you know, I want to embrace my woman more, for sure. I know that. You know, I've always been afraid of taking the lead. I'm really comfortable in like that supporting character and like that great script, and you know you've got your good five scenes, you know what you're gonna do, and you come in, you come out, and you're great, maybe because you come in and you come out, or maybe it's easier for me to watch because I come in and I come out. But from this, I'm no longer afraid. I was functioning from fear for a couple years. I think that just happens, hopefully, to everybody at one point in their life. But for me, it really did happen. Where I was afraid to fail. And I was afraid to be seen, you know, and too much, you know. And so I want to embrace me and my woman and more women, strong women, complicated women. And I'm okay. I think I can carry a movie, the right role. Maybe, you know, like I'm not afraid that I can't figure that out. And so I just want to stick down that path of being courageous and playing courageous roles and not being afraid to like shine or like use my sexuality a little bit more. I also had that under like guard for a really long time. Which is why I was playing, like, you know, wallflowers or drug addicts. So it's like, just, you know, so yeah.
So even though Marilyn in some way suffered from all of that and became objectified on some level, remains objectified, I guess, on some level, for you, a place of freedom.
Well, I suppose. I don't know if it's like a... Yes, it's a place of freedom for me, but not to be an object, but to just not be afraid of that side of myself, you know? I think a woman's sexuality is part of her gift, and it's part of her communication and her tool belt. And I think it's very strong to be able to use it. I don't think it's anti-feminist or, you know, like these weirder... too much of a object, you know? I mean, especially when you can back it up with, if you can back it up with talent and brains and, you know, a real human, I think it's a very, very powerful tool that I wasn't using not to say that I use it either. I'm just not going to be afraid of it, you know? Mm-hmm. I had to step out of my comfort zone. I've never, like, simulated sex in a movie ever. Like, that's, you know, like, you do that. Like, women do that. And I'd realize, mm-hmm. like, how have I been acting for 15 years and never, like, simulated a sex scene? Mm-hmm. And I was, like, nervous with, and Jeffrey knew. And he was like, Garner, like, how did this happen? I'm like, I'm telling you, it's, like, my first, really, it's, like, my first time. I did some PG stuff on Pan Am with Goran Visnjic. Handsome man, a lucky girl. But you know,
you think you just avoided those roles up until then?
I avoided my sexuality for a really long time. I think that's why it's a place of freedom for me. If you know me at all, I knew how to flirt, but I didn't know how to back it up. Mm. So I'd get myself in trouble a lot too when I was younger. Now I know how to back it up and control it and be confident in it and be proud of it. And you know, so. Oh boy, now I just feel like I'm talking about my sexuality.
Well, but do you feel like up until then you just didn't go in for things? You undermined that part of it to the point where you couldn't get the job or didn't get the job? I mean...
Yeah, I think so. Mm. I do think so. Or I think I was just, would lie to myself and be like, no, I'm not interested in that role. I don't want to play that one. You know, because I just didn't want to go there. And you know, you struggle, you know, I didn't feel sexy enough or pretty enough, you know. I was like, oh, I'll play that girl with, like, who's cool to be missing a tooth, because I was. It's the reason why Larry Clark hired me in the first place, was because I was genuinely missing a tooth from my mouth, and he found that beautiful and fascinating and, like, added to just another layer to a character. So I think also I'd also gotten guided by these people or certain actors that I dated that were like artists to, like, do something, and so it just took me a while to, like, to be okay with a more feminine, softer, vulnerable versions of myself, you know, to not hide.
No, I find it one of the most fascinating issues for women, particularly right now, where it's so, there's so much political talk about women all the time now, and it's so heightened to the point of, you know, rage a lot of the time over, you never quite know where to step, and what's fair, but ultimately, you know, to be a woman in the world who uses her beauty is to be, there's power within, and there's, you can't control what's without, you know, you do get objectified, but it's not because you objectify yourself. It's but it's like a weird thing, and I think people are generally afraid to talk about it too much or think about it too much.
Or own it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I'm glad you are.
Oh, thank you. It's just been such an important conversation for me in the last year of my life. It's just really, really, really come up a lot. Just that relationship with myself. So I'm happy to talk about it, you know? I think it's a beautiful thing.